If you want to learn how to measure and plot temperatures, build wireless radio controllers, use servos to drive tools, or build weird things like, I don't know, a thermal camera, here, you'll learn mechatronics in minutes. So far, we have focused on reading analog and digital signals. This week, we'll learn how to write an analog signal. Analog signals vary in magnitude, so they're perfect for changing LED brightness, varying fan speed, or dimming stuff like LCD displays. Let's jump right in and vary the brightness on each color of an LED. The command we'll explore today is analog write, and you pass in the pin number and the duty cycle. Analog write only works with digital pins, and on an Arduino, only a few can be used. The second argument is the duty cycle, and it's kind of like a percentage output. A 50% duty cycle will output around 2.5 volts on an Arduino. I'll explain this more in a minute. Wiring up the LED is pretty easy. We'll connect each of the leads to a digital pin that supports PWM generation. Also, since LEDs don't like 5 volts, we'll wire in a series resistor. A 220 ohm will drop the voltage just enough to keep it from burning out. Ground, of course, goes to ground. To pulse each LED, we'll write a simple loop. Unlike the 10-bit analog read, analog write is only 8 bits, so the maximum output value is 255. One loop for each color will be used and we'll keep it simple and pulse them individually. The pins being passed to analog write are very specific pins. If you're using an Arduino, you have a limited set of pins, noted by the tilde symbol. Something like a Teensy has a much wider range of what pins can be used for analog write. One last thing is don't forget to use pin mode output to declare you will write data on the digital pin. A 1 millisecond delay should produce a snappy pulse. Notice how we have a second loop to dim each of the LED colors. Each color pulses brighter before dimming out. So that's a visual example of what analog write does, but what is it actually doing? Let's connect an oscilloscope to the red pin and see what is being written. We'll add a pot to analog A0 so we can vary the signal and feed in that signal right into our analog write. A few changes will be needed to the code. First, we'll comment out the pulsing so we can focus on what happens with the pot. Since we read at 10 bits and write at 8 bits, we'll simply divide the read signal by 4 and pass that value directly to the analog write. Upload the code and monitor the pin with an oscilloscope. Notice how the output is a square wave with a constant cycle. As we vary the signal from the pot, notice how the percentage on is changing. This type of wave is called pulse width modulation, PWM for short. The longer the signal is on, the higher the effective voltage. When the duty cycle is, say, 127, you'll get a 50% duty cycle. Remember, the resolution is 8 bits, or up to 256 steps. The last example is how this PWM signal can vary a fan speed. Unfortunately, the pin output power on these MCUs is pretty small and cannot power a fan, so we'll need to add some type of driver circuit. A transistor is a common way to drive very low current devices like this cooling fan. The 2N2222 transistor acts like a switch. Add some current from the MCU to the base and the ground loop is closed, completing the fan circuit. Turn off the signal and the transistor opens, breaking the circuit, which, as you can probably guess, stops the fan. If we apply our PWM signal to the base, the transistor will conduct accordingly, meaning it will switch on and off very quickly and vary the current through the fan. The use of PWM is a pretty common way to control the speed of DC devices, like motors. The fan is powered with a different supply source, so don't forget to connect all the grounds together. We'll keep the red LED in place so you can see some visual indicator as to what the fan should be doing. A flyback or snubber diode is added to prevent charge buildup at the transistor's collector. Also, we'll keep the pot connected to the analog pin, that way we can vary the speed manually. Since we're using the same code from above, the pot will control the brightness and the fan speed. So here's analog write in action. Watch as we increase the pot position, the duty cycle for the PWM increases, the fan speeds up, and the LED gets brighter. If you're thinking of putting this type of speed controller on your Tesla, forget this circuit. This transistor-based driver is fine for low current applications, but for high current devices like a motor, that's a job for a MOSFET and a dedicated gate driver. Selecting the right components can be pretty complicated, and that's for a later date. As you can imagine, analog write comes with challenges. The write frequencies we're using here are very low and will cause a growling sound because it's a frequency that's in the audible range of the human ear. Some pins on the Arduino support a slightly higher frequency, but are still in the audible range. You can mess with the internal clock to speed things up, but that will mess up your clock. Also, the higher the frequency, the more complicated the driver circuit becomes. If you need better frequency control and higher write resolution, Teensies are magical as they have a function to specify the write frequency. They also have a function to specify the write resolution up to 16 bits. Because of the analog write-to-frequency control, you can use Teensies for better quality alarms, or maybe start your own garage band. Well, that covers this week's lesson. If you learned something, give me a thumbs up. If you have a tip to share, leave a comment so my subs can learn more. Thanks for watching.